Hi there. It is January 16th, 2022, and there was a pretty significant event that happened in the world, geologic event yesterday on January 15th. So I thought I'd put together a short video to maybe explain a little bit about why that happened and explain and provide a little bit of insight regarding this big event. So the big event I'm referring to was a underwater volcanic eruption in the Tongan area. Along with a tsunami that it created. And so maybe to start with, we can start a little bit with kind of an overview of where Tonga is and why we have volcanic activity in that area. So this is the South Pacific. Here's the east coast of Australia. And Tonga is in the South Pacific and lies north of New Zealand here, right along this plate boundary. This is a plate boundary where the Pacific plate to the east is being shoved beneath the Australian plate, which is this plate to the west. And so this is what we call a subduction zone. And so subduction zones produce these deep water trenches. You can see the darker shade of blue here. This is where one plate dives beneath the other. This is where we get a lot of earthquakes. Most of the earthquake activity on the planet, including the largest and most destructive earthquakes, tend to take place at subduction zones like these. It's also a place where we get volcanic activity, and typically this type of subduction zone in the ocean will form a chain of volcanic islands. And those volcanoes can be quite explosive, as we saw with this event yesterday. So if we kind of zoom in here a little bit on Tonga here, we can see Samoa to the north, Fiji off to the west. The main island of Tonga, the most populated, is here. And just a little bit to the north is a little island or set of islands here called Hunga, Tonga, if I'm pronouncing that right. And the volcanic activity here really was no surprise to geologists. This is an area that's been active both historically and in prehistory, a little bit as well. We had some activity here in 2009. There was some underwater explosions that took place along the kind of to the southwest of the island. And then in 2015, you can see this kind of new cone here and this little kind of lake behind it. We had eruptions and these beaches here with this darker material. This is actually ash and volcanic material that's washed up onto the beach from this eruption. So this eruption in 2015 actually created this cone, which kind of merged these two islands together, more or less. The activity, there's a set of reefs down here, and then the activity or the eruption that took place yesterday happened just south of the island, kind of in this region here. And this was over a region, these are separated by a couple of miles, so we had several miles of ocean floor that was disturbed. And if we switch to a little different view here, we can see that the map area here shows an interesting geologic story. So there's the two islands with the eruption in 2015 that built up this cone that we just looked at on Google Earth, the eruption site of 2009. But what's more impressive here, and what's shown by this dotted line encircling this region, is this is actually where we have a caldera. And a caldera is where we had at one point a large volcano that collapsed in on itself. So at one point this volcanic system had a big enough eruption that it collapsed in on itself beneath the ocean, probably triggered a tsunami at that time as well. And I believe this caldera eruption occurred about 1,000 or so years ago. And so for the most part this volcano has been under the ocean. And what we can also see here is the depth of the water below sea level. So we can see the shallower zones here, those two reefs I pointed out, of course the two islands themselves, and then the center of the volcano is a little bit deeper, maybe several hundred feet, maybe up to 600 or so feet below sea level. And so the eruption, if you watch some of the social media posts and things that came out over the last few days, this is kind of what it looks like from space. And so this big eruption of this very sticky, pasty magma that becomes explosive. Basically, the gases have accumulated in this magma to the point that they can overcome the pressure, not just of the overlying seawater, but of the stickiness of the magma itself. We can see the eruption from space was pretty visible. This is the one I was looking for here. But you can see this big ash plume here. Once the eruption occurred at the seafloor, it not just pushed the water up, but it was a, had enough explosive energy to leave the ocean and go into the atmosphere about 12 to 13 miles up into the sky, which is pretty remarkable, putting that, those ash and volcanic particles up into the stratosphere. The diameter of this thing's about 3 or so miles across, and again, it put that stuff, you know, good 12 or so miles into the atmosphere. So a very violent eruption with a lot of energy. Had this happened on land, it would have been a neat event, but probably wouldn't have had the notoriety and the press coverage that it did. And so the main reason why it was so so covered in so many places was that the tsunami that the eruption produced was significant enough that it actually triggered tsunami warnings across the Pacific Ocean. So not just the west coast of the US, but Japan and other countries in the region all had their own tsunami warnings, warning people of the waves that were coming. So as that eruption displaced and pushed up the seawater, it pushed the seawater out in all directions, and that created the tsunami. It's a little bit different mechanism than we see with earthquakes, where the seafloor breaks vertically and pushes up a larger amount of water over a longer area. So our earthquake-generated tsunami tend to be larger. Nonetheless, this triggered a tsunami, and we don't have a lot of modern precedents for volcanically produced or generated tsunami. And to my knowledge, this is the only one I can think of in recent memory. The one historically was in 1883, the Krakatoa eruption in Indonesia produced a massive tsunami. That was a much bigger eruption than this one. But nonetheless, kind of an interesting event. You can see, if I show the rest of the video here, you'll see the tsunami waves in Tonga were about 4 feet high or so, which doesn't sound like a lot, but remember, this is a low-lying area, and when you bring sea level up and push the water forward, even with a depth of only 4 feet or so, the damage can be pretty significant. And so they've had some pretty significant damage across Tonga and in a few other places in the area as well. And so luckily, as those waves came into the U.S. and other places, they weren't substantially large, but with the unknown factors of how those waves might interact with tide conditions and other waves in the area, they were just trying to be conservative and keeping people off beaches. So we weren't worried so much about a big wave pushing inland along the coast of California or someplace like that, but mainly getting people out of those coastal areas where they could be safe. So again, just kind of a quick summary of where this occurred, why it's significant, and hopefully that helps explain a little bit about why we had this eruption in Tonga and why there was a tsunami. So thanks for tuning in.